Good afternoon and welcome at Business Matters Live. Co-host Sander Kaasjager, what is the highlight of the week for you?
Well, Aldo, thanks for having me. And I just came out of my highlight because I had a great meeting just now. We had the honor to facilitate that at the embassy between Polish business and Dutch business on the CPK. You know the CPK project?
Yeah.
So the CPK, what is it?
The CPK is the new airport that's going to be built.
Exactly, that one. It's a huge project and it's really picking up pace now. Polish government is very serious about it. And we've been knocking on the door for quite a while to try to position Dutch business in that project. So for the design phase, but also for the implementation phase. And the door was opened, and they showed very serious interest in the Dutch expertise in, for example, aerotropolis development, urban development, smart city development. So we had 43 participants in the meeting, so it was really like a workshop. And very interesting, ranging from, let's say, architectural companies to the Schiphol Airport Development Company, to the Netherlands Aerospace Center.
And you're basically connecting them to the Polish counterparts.
Yeah, exactly. And there was a lot of inspiration and energy going. There were sparks going hence and forth. It was very interesting to see. So that really gave me a lot of energy. But what was your highlight of today?
My highlight of today is the program of today, yes?
Of course.
So we're excited to hear the new guests that are upcoming. They are sitting ready to tell their stories. For the moment, Sander, thank you very much for your story. And we go to the main guest of today.
Good luck.
So,
thank you so much.
Welcome again at Business Matters Live, the video podcast that signals trends and identifies issues and opportunities for doing business in Poland. Let me tell you first that you as a visitor, viewer, can ask your questions to the guests that we have here at the table. So put your questions in the chat and they will be discussed with our guests. I will discuss them here on the table. Today we receive an update on the Polish macroeconomy by award-winning economist Rafał Benecki from the ING Bank Śląski. Welcome. We also talk about the retail industry in Poland with Mark Benning, owner of Euroshare. That's later to come in this program. But we start with our first guest, Jeroen Tiel, Regional Managing Director Poland and Eastern Europe at Randstad. Welcome.
Thank you.
Hello. COVID-19 has changed the phase of recruiting overnight. We are going to discuss how this global health crisis has changed hiring and how will talent acquisition recover when this is all over. But first, I want to start off with three statements that can only be answered by yes or no.
That's easy, maybe.
You might think it's easy, okay. But it might also be difficult. COVID-19 has turned the job market into an employer market. So in this way, COVID-19 is good for employers. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. I would have rather been regional managing director of Randstad Poland and Eastern Europe in a different time. Yes or no?
No.
Okay. Polish workforce is more resilient to the current crisis than workforce in most other countries. Yes or no?
Full yes.
Yes. Okay, so it's two times a yes, one time a no.
Correct.
Yeah. That's food for thought and food for discussion maybe for later on.
Yeah.
But I would like to discuss first the current market that we have. I remember that in 2017 we discussed an employer brand survey at that time. Salary and benefits ranked extremely high then.
Correct. Yeah.
During COVID-19, you have done new research. Can you tell something about that?
Yeah, well, I can. We're in the midst of the research, Elro. I can talk about it. Of course, in the past, it was indeed the benefits and salary. But what we see now already in the halfway the research, that there are three topics that are important right now. First of all, financially healthy company. That makes sense, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Second of all, job security. And third of all, the type of contract. That mm-hmm. is what we see changing in, let's say, what is important for employees when it comes to an employer brand and what candidates looking at in terms of what they find crucial to accept a job or not.
We have some slides. Looking at them at the moment. Can you maybe explain how that works and what's important there?
Yeah, what we see here is, let's say, the development of the assessment of risk of losing employment. It's not a coincidence that in the last couple of quarters these figures are rather high. And what you see here in the red bar is a high level of uncertainty in terms of the risk, and the gray bar is immediate. We're almost back on the level of Q2, where it all started, where the uncertainty was very high, and we can see now clearly that we are back on that level. And I can also tell you that what we notice in January and also partly in February, that we're still there, and uncertainty is still on quite high level.
And you see in the four last bar, it's lower, and the last bar is higher again. Why is that sweeping so much?
I think we all had the same thing. When COVID hit us, we had the idea, well, this is really bad, but we felt it's a couple of months, summer is coming, we're okay. And then reality came into place and it was not okay. And then you see that this little lift up was not sustainable for sure. We're on a level which is quite high if you compare the last couple of years.
I know we have also a second slide.
Yeah. Maybe we can see the second slide. But you see here, on the one hand, it's about the risk of losing your job, but maybe even more important, how do you see the opportunity to find a new job? And also here we see a strong decline in Q2, again lifting up again in Q3, mm-hmm. and declining again in Q4, which is more or less the lowest that we have ever had. And we're already measuring this for years. And I can tell you, like I just shared with you, that also in January and February we experienced the same. Though it's really dependent in which sectors we reflect this, because there are areas, and probably our guest on the table will share that later on, that are doing very well, and there are areas that are doing very bad. But in general, what you see here is the fear that people have of the ability to find a new job.
Right, right. And so the market has turned in an employer market right now, yes?
I would say if you have to make the balance, yes. But I can tell you that there are areas where it's still very difficult to find skilled people and the right people. So they will find will have a different opinion, but in general, if you take the total country, yes.
Okay, could you lift out some sectors where it's still difficult to find people?
Well, for example, if you talk about e-commerce or e-commerce related industries, or you talk about logistics and third-party logistics, these sectors have benefited from the COVID consequences very much, and what you see is that the demand is very high, and it's also difficult to find the right stuff. Also taken into consideration that COVID measurements also had an impact in terms of finding the people at the right moment and the right time.
Right. And could you then also say that is there a relation and do you have those data about salaries of people? Is that climbing not so fast anymore?
Yeah. Well, here you see something interesting. So I just shared with you that there was an uncertainty about the potentially loss of your job. Also the high level of uncertainty of finding a new job, but salary demands are quite high. Mm-hmm. We see the development of salaries that are taking quite a step forward, even the last quarter. And I think that many of the companies face the fact that they are in this squeeze, the demand from their employees in order to increase salaries to a certain extent, the uncertainty that we still have. It's a very difficult balance, because I just shared with you, there are sectors where there's a lot of demand, so there is competition on this part, for sure.
Okay. But you would say that when the opportunities for finding a new job are rather low, employees know this, and they will adjust their own expectations towards salary.
Yeah, you would say so, but there's something in terms of a perception and reality.
Okay.
And I think that there's a lot of uncertainty and perception about not being able to find a job. At the same time, in our company, we faced quarter four, which was extremely good. So there was a lot of demand.
Okay.
So there is the difference that I think is very interesting to talk about.
Yeah. If you compare Poland to other Randstad, other countries of Randstad over let's say Europe, and even you can say maybe something more about Central Europe. Yeah. How does Poland compare to the region?
Well, Poland did better than most of the countries surrounding us. Not a total surprise, because in 2008, when the financial crisis hit us, also Poland was capable of performing well. And there are some countries that really faced a very strong downturn. And in Poland, the same, but not in the same level. So I'm really impressed how resilient the Polish economy is. And it's also connected to the nature of the business in Poland and the interesting part for logistics, for the SSE BPO market, for example. It's for sure bringing a lot.
Right. You mentioned those I would say new highlights for employers, employer brand topics, financial healthy companies. Coming back to the discussion that we had in 2017, that report that you came up with, salary and the benefits for employees are key. That was most important. So companies like KPMG were on the top, because they pay a lot to their... Do you also see now that also in current surveys for employers, that the ones that are not paying a lot but are financially healthy and doing a lot in terms of security or can offer a lot in security also coming up higher now? Do you really see that in that report also reflected?
I would say that it's a balance. You know, if you pay low or at the minimum and you have nothing else to offer, then I think you will have a very difficult situation in attracting and, more important, retaining people. If you're not the company that pays the highest in your sector or in your region, but you are capable of establishing an employer brand which is connected to well-being, connected to security and those kind of things, you might cover this gap. And that's, of course, the competitive advantage that every company tries to find.
We also discussed in the past rising salaries and the tension of companies to automate. We're in a completely different playing field at the moment. What about automation and trying to make to develop your company in that way?
Well, let's say automation is not something that started during the COVID time. It already started before, and I think this is one of the trends that we see in multiple industries. I do think that the COVID situation speeded it up or gave more insights that it is possible to develop here. It's a reality that we have to face. Whether it will replace jobs fully, I don't think so. I think we'll have a shift in profiles. And yes, automation in certain areas will be, I wouldn't say the new normal, but it will be for sure present.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, but not any real big shifts caused by COVID.
Well, not specifically by COVID, but by automation, you could say that some jobs are disappearing and new jobs will arise. You know. You can become a drone operator now or a drone pilot, and that is something that 5-6 years ago nobody would have thought of.
Right. One final thing that I would like to discuss with you, and we discussed this before, is the supply chains. Supply chains and getting products from Asia being much bigger risks since COVID. So the supply chains are shifting. You are in contact with Randstad with a lot of big producers here in Poland. Do you notice anything of that?
Well, what I would say that we notice based on the talks that we have is that many companies faced the consequence of being dependent on far away. Many companies face the fact that they have to maybe reorganize their supply chain in order to be able to deal with these kind of crisis that we had, because I don't think it's a one-time event. It might happen again in the future. So it changes the strategy of a company. So that's one. Then specifically for Poland, I would say, the benefit here that you have, specifically to the SSE BPO market, where we see, after some slowdown last year, interest from investors to come to Poland, interest from companies to extend their shared service centers that they have here, and interest to even move or add more components here. I think that's a really thing that is happening right now and very positive for the Polish market and for the Polish labor market.
Shared service centers, so back office activities being done here. Is it only shared services, or can you also say something about other markets?
Well, look, for example, at the investment that LG is doing in batteries. Look at the investments that Amazon is doing, for example, in their fulfillment centers. So I think there's a lot of things going on here, and it's not a coincidence that Poland is well positioned here, I would say.
Okay. Thank you very much. Please stay at the table, because we're going to discuss furthermore, and maybe later on we can discuss with the two guests together. I would also warmly like to invite all participants in the video to send in questions. At the moment, we have the first question. Do you see a difference in the labor market for white or blue collar And where do you see a bigger demand? Is a question from one of the people that watch the program.
Oh, this question is spot on. Because currently the demand for blue collar is very high, but in white collar it's different, besides the sector that I mentioned in terms of SSC, BPO.
Okay.
But if you take administrative jobs in itself, if you take those kind of profiles, there's less demand. Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Good. Thanks for that question, and please let them come. Those questions, because we can right away answer them. Also at the table we have Chief Economist of the ING Bank Slansky, Rafał Benecki. Thank you very much for joining. Let's look at the big data, the GDP data that we have for 2020 and for 2021. Decrease of 2.8 in 2020 and an increase of 4.2. That's the forecast for this year. I don't know if this is also your forecast for this year, or that you're slightly in a different.
It's my forecast.
It's your forecast. Yes, it's your forecast. Okay. Could you give us some insight in, I would say, one or two levels deeper, what is going behind those figures?
Yeah, first of all, 2020 is the first year we experienced recession in the last 30 years. But interestingly, our recession was much shallower than in the neighboring countries. So we had half of what we have seen in Eurozone and Czech Republic. So that's number one interesting story. Not surprising, because in the past we also performed a bit better. The factors which are driving Polish economy that well is diversification of the economy. So we are not automotive monoculture. The Polish economy is very diversified, and is also comparing to the Western countries, it's not that based on the services sector, but it's more manufacturing economy. So given what we have seen in the second half of the previous year, where global manufacturing export rebounded, we benefited from that as well. Also interestingly, we are not the economy which relies on touristic sector, our Horeca, and widely speaking, so that was also beneficial. What is also common to other neighboring countries is that sensitivity of the economy to the pandemic shock is lower. This is something we are seeing in Poland, in Czech Republic, in Eurozone, and generally globally. So in numbers, in the second half of the year, the number of new COVID cases grew significantly, a few times.
Yeah.
But simultaneously, the restriction imposed by the authorities and by household on their own were by a quarter less painful. So more cases, less restrictions, but GDP contraction was like one-tenth of what we have experienced in the second quarter. So we are seeing that the economy, Polish, but also Eurozone and the CE countries, is less sensitive to COVID, and that is very beneficial for this year. For this year, as you said, we are expecting 4.5. Although we no longer expect upside risk to this forecast, we rather expect downside risk.
Yeah.
But still, that looks good. Although we have to admit that we are no longer expecting very rapid rebound in the second quarter, we are experiencing the third wave of COVID.
Yeah.
Also, lockdowns are extended in the Netherlands, in Germany, in some countries no, but generally speaking, in main trading partners they are extended. So probably we should see that rebound will come at the end of second quarter, middle of the year, and second half of 21.
Right, and that resilience that you mentioned, yes, the resilience of the Polish people, of the Polish economy, will that also help in the future, in this year, in the years to come?
Yeah, I think so. We estimated a kind of activity indices for the Eurozone and for Poland, just to estimate and check how painful is the third wave, how painful is the extension of lockdowns in Germany, in Netherlands, And it looks like there was a slowdown in some northern Eurozone countries, including Netherlands and Germany, while in the entire Eurozone it wasn't that painful, and in Poland also wasn't that painful. So we are expecting that the first quarter should be flat in quarter-on-quarter terms, in terms of GDP. Also, thankfully, the global manufacturing sector is performing quite well. So again, this is the driving force for the region, for Poland. The Asia is open. The Eurozone export seems may suffer, but not that much. And the Polish companies are seeing quite a resilient dynamic of new orders, a bit weaker, but still not that bad. So we think the quarter-on-quarter GDP dynamic should be flat, and then the second quarter should bring recovery, not as strong as we thought before, but still, and the second half of the year should be quite robust.
Yeah, one big motor of the economy is also consumer spending. We discussed with Jeroen that salaries are not going down, but slowly going up. Yeah. What is this element in the economy doing? Can you tell something more about that?
Yeah, that's at the moment the main driver of the growth. The second most important is export, while investment are quite weak. Mm-hmm. So this is the picture, and the COVID pandemic and the last recession even strengthened this kind of backdrop of the Polish GDP. So a bit weaker investment, especially private investment, very robust consumption, and very strong export. This is because of this resilience of the global manufacturing sector. So the Poles are benefiting from very generous fiscal stimulus. Interestingly, Polish government delivered one of the highest fiscal stimulus in Europe, was 6.7% of GDP, so quite generous. Thankfully, the unemployment growth was quite limited, and propensity to spend stay quite elevated. So each time we see reopening of the economy, the consumption is rebounding very strongly. And that will be, we will see that this year as well.
Right. When we look at COVID, could you maybe tell something about the connection between Polish industry to those big circles of the automotive, of other electronic circles? Poland is connected to that regional industries, right? What did COVID do for that connection of the Polish economy? Because the background is that Poland is to a certain level always pretty low in those circles. They should add more knowledge to that. What can you say about this in relation to COVID?
Mm-hmm. The strength of the economy is that, as I said, we are not monoculture, automotive monoculture. The automotive sector suffered before the pandemic. It recovered a bit, but it is suffering from supply chain disruptions. Mm-hmm. So that is disturbing production recovery in those sectors, which is very painful for our neighboring countries, especially from south of CE. The Polish export is more diversified. Polish companies are producing also consumer goods, intermediate goods. So thankfully, they are a bit more reliant on the local supply chains. So given that, our export was rebounding quite strongly, and should do that in the coming months as well. I think COVID related supply shock in the supply chains is probably a bit more seen in the automotive than the other sectors.
Yeah. We have now two interesting companies at the table, ING and Randstad. Jeroen, your chance for a free consult. Any questions to To Rafał about economy or
well, my question would not be a question, but more or less a hope. So the forecast that you have for the second half year, a robust development, I really hope is going to happen, because that will be good for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not a question, but wish, I would say.
Yeah.
And you're right, I see the strength of the Polish economy and what we are strong at. So let's hope that we indeed have this development, and I think that if the surrounding countries will start recovering in the same way, we will only benefit from it.
Yeah.
Just to comment in a few words, so much depends on the vaccination process.
Correct.
Because that fast vaccination is letting government to reopen economy and the economy to rebound. So we are following that topic very closely. And Europe as a whole, I mean, European Union is lagging behind UK and the US. Yeah. So vaccination in EU is 2-3 times slower than there.
Yeah.
But interestingly, European Commission is trying to do its best to raise the supply of the vaccine.
Yeah.
So we hope that 50% of the population should be vaccinated somewhere in July.
Yeah.
I think incomparable pace in Netherlands, Poland, and in Germany.
Yeah, yeah.
So that should let governments to reopen. And interestingly, there is increasing number of researches which are showing that vaccine is helping to lower number of serious disease,
right,
hospitalizations,
right,
and in many cases also transmission.
Yeah.
So we hope that that picture will change, and Europe will catch up with UK and US. So that is strong. That is strong assumption we are taking in this forecast.
Sure.
Yeah.
My question to you,
is please, go ahead.
We were very positively surprised with the high demand on labor in the second half of the year.
Yeah.
Was it because of quarantines, or because of just sound demand for labor associated with sound production and activity?
It was the latter. So it was definitely a sound demand for labor. I think that certain industries, like I said, e-commerce, for example, or logistics, they saw an enormous increase in their activities and therefore a need for labor. I think there was also a connection in terms of, because of the quarantine, the Ukrainian workforce was less, not capable, it's the wrong word, but available to do the same kinds of jobs. So that increased the demand for the Polish labor force. So I said it in the beginning to Elho, we faced one of the best quarters that we've had in Q4, and pure demand. So that was quite impressive to see. Yeah. But also a surprise, because end of Q2, I didn't have that feeling that was going to happen.
Okay. That's a very good message.
I think we could talk for two more editions of Business Matters Live.
Right.
A very interesting topic. Thank you for joining the program and explaining the topics. And we go to our next guest. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's my mission and that of the entire economic team at the embassy to promote trade between the Netherlands and Poland. And I'm pretty sure that, like Rafael did, I can boost your confidence to invest in that trade. Because I have brought some quite encouraging statistics. It's our first show, and it has been pouring annual reports since the start of this year. So let's set the scene and have a look at what our trade relation actually looks like. So, as you can see, trade flows have been growing rapidly for a number of years now, triggered by Poland entering the EU in 2004. In 2019, Dutch exports to Poland totaled 13.5 billion euros. That makes Poland the 8th export destination for the Netherlands, one place above China. But uwaga, only 6.2 billion euro of that is actually made in Holland. The larger part consists of re-exported goods. So here we see Netherlands' gateway to Europe. So what are we exporting? 40% of Dutch exports is machinery and equipment, 22% manufactured goods. The agri-food sector accounts for roughly 20%. And I'll squeeze in a fun fact here. Did you know that 80% of the cut flowers you see in Poland are actually coming from the Netherlands? The import of goods, so the imports,
So Polish exports to the Netherlands have grown from 2 billion euros in 2004 to 9 billion euros in 2019, as you can see in this graph. Roughly a third of those goods are machinery and equipment, and another big chunk is manufactured goods. So the whiz kids among us have already done the math. The Netherlands has a trade surplus of 4.5 billion euros, which is visible in the purple bar. But as I said, this is slightly misleading because a large share is re-exported goods. Now, what's really remarkable is the fact that provisional data for 2020 indicate that Dutch exports to Poland has actually increased despite the pandemic. After a strong dip in April-May, as you can see in this graph, exports recovered and increased with 4% on average over the first three quarters of 2020. When I looked into that, it turns out that the increase in exports of goods is due to a strong growth of re-export of electrical equipment from the Netherlands, or should I say, from Asia. But also export of flour and plants, for example, went up with 3.4%. Moving to trade in services, that had also increased sharply in recent years. The Netherlands imports more services from Poland than it exports to Poland. The development of that trade surplus for Poland is shown in this graph. You can see that exports to Netherlands went up to 4 billion euros in 2019, and which is a staggering four times as much as in 2014. Dutch exports of services also increased quite significantly, by the way, because that went up from 1.8 billion euro to 3.3 billion in 2019. So in both directions, our trade flow in services was dominated by transport and logistics services, accounting for almost 50%. Consultancy and ITC are third and second, respectively. Then the fourth sector, interestingly, is construction services for Poland, or maybe it's not very surprising, and aviation services from the Netherlands, or should I say, was the biggest chunk. Well, I think I should end on a positive note and mention that the Netherlands is the largest investor in Poland. If we only count investment of purely Dutch origin, so not through investment, as I would call it, we are top 10 investor in Poland. Maybe a last word on upcoming events of the embassy. The embassy has commissioned four market surveys that might interest you. And they will be shortly presented as well. It's on water retention. Second is on rail freight. The third is on circular economy. And the fourth is on offshore wind. So please check out our social media, in particular the LinkedIn page of our economic department. And the first big event that we're organizing, or actually co-organizing, is the Rail Freight Summit from 31st of May until the 2nd of June, which will probably be a hybrid conference. So that's it for me. Next time, I hope to talk more about the future and dive into some sectors with high potential for Dutch Polish business. Back to you, Aron.
So, welcome back at the table of Business Matters Live, the video podcast that signals trends and identifies issues and opportunities for doing business in Poland. Those issues and opportunities we're going to discuss with Mark Benning, owner of Euroshare. Euroshare is the owner, exporter and distributor of dairy products. They are buying from 11 or 17 countries and selling in Poland and exporting to 8 countries. Well, I'm not especially sure. We're going to discuss that in a moment. Mark, the Netherlands has a very special taste. Dutch people have a very special taste for cheese. The Polish have the same. Yeah. How do you end up here in Poland being successful in the cheese business?
How I ended up in Poland? First of all, thank you for inviting me. Ended up by being asked 28 years ago now by the owner of the brand of Old Amsterdam if I would not like to start to sell cheese in Poland. I did not thought that long about it. I just stopped with study, took a bus, put some cheese inside and went to Poland.
Okay.
And I'm still here.
So. Okay.
And the success, yes, I think I'm still here, so yes.
Okay, we have seen many stories over the years of people, entrepreneurs, going to Poland and starting here, but then being successful. That's the next question, yes? How and that relates to my first question. Mm-hmm. Cheese is very typical, yes? Mm-hmm. We have a very typical cheese or choice for taste for cheese. If I ask my my daughter and her friends taste the Dutch cheese, then my daughter likes it, but her Polish friends don't like it. So how do you find that out? What is the trick to become successful here with cheese?
First of all, cheese in general in Poland or in Holland, they are eating Gouda cheese. Only in Holland we take a piece of bread, we put Gouda on, and here they put a salad under, some meat, some cheese, and some ketchup. So the taste of the Gouda is a little less important. So that's why we are focused on the premium dairy products, with a little higher level, where the taste is more important, not the price only, as if you put the ketchup on, you will not taste it. So that's why we focused on about 400 premium cheese products where we're selling to the retails, and finding, of course, the tastes, what the people like, because Polish consumers want to invent. They want to taste something new, and they are not afraid, and they're not willing to stick all the time into the same product.
Elro, you know my last name?
Kaasjager.
So for the non-Dutch speaking, Kaasjager means cheese hunter. So thanks for inviting me on this table.
Yeah, absolutely.
So my first question would be, if you hunt for cheese in Poland, what is then the best-selling cheese? So what's the most popular one?
It stays Gouda. It stays the Gouda type, but made in blocks in Poland. So that takes, and the white cheeses, as they call it here, Twaruk, will stay the number one.
And what is developing? What is let's say, is it changing, or are the preferences more or less stable over the years?
It's changing. Premium products, so the more, I would say, tasteful cheeses are growing quite rapidly. As people are changing to another habit, they are more enjoying the evening with a bottle, let's say, of water with a piece of cheese, than before. So that's changing, that's developing. You can see it also, the movement that has come from the hyper to the discounts, and the discounts also offer more premium products.
And are you also considering, I mean, your business is growing, right? It's are you considering to move your production also to Poland? Because I know that the agricultural sector is also developing in Poland. Are you still just importing?
One thing, we import from many countries are ready products to Poland, ready for the consumer, but a big part we buy as raw material where we cut and slice ourselves, and so we can prepare it as our clients request.
When companies from the Netherlands are going to Poland, regardless what industry they're in, we sometimes get the question, should we bring in our own products, our own tastes, or should we develop something that is in Poland popular? What advice would you give them?
So first of all, both options, of course, are possible. Because trends are changing, let's see, to the plant-based products. Of course, it's produced in Poland, but most probably we have very strong, good producers in Holland. So in that case, you could say, I would take it from Holland. On the long run, if you will still be competitive, is a question, if you want to have the big market. So it really depends on the products, to be honest. That is not really solved.
No, we had one company, and maybe I can give that example. They wanted to bring in Polish pierogi. Good idea or not?
Yeah, I would say the idea is good. It's only a little surprising. So what's the unique thing from the Dutch pierogi to Poland? What's unique in this, and why it should be purchased by a consumer? What's the reason for them? Because it's Dutch? Yeah. I think it will not work.
You mentioned already the trend in meatless products, and they had a meatless pierogi.
Yeah, but we had the Russian, so with the twaruk inside, we have pieczarki inside, so the mushrooms.
Right.
So let's be honest, it's existing.
So what are your goals in product development, or let's say, what are your goals for the future, for example?
Very important, and also what changed in the trends, is that pre-packed cheeses is developing quite fast. Because if you go into the supermarkets, the cheese counter for meat, for fish, because of the COVID, there's a distance. I'm a little afraid to have the contact directly, especially in the first half year when it started. It's a little changing, but this meant that we as a company have to produce small consumer units which are normally sold in a cheese counter. Yeah? So there we're developing, okay. There we have invested in machines and packaging to get this supply to our clients.
So basically that's marketing also.
Of course, of course. Yeah.
So the product doesn't change that much.
That's correct, but the solution is there. And that's, I would say, the solution is at the end the most important. Otherwise it will not end at the consumer at the table.
That is your industry. That is the dairy market. Mm-hmm. Many of our viewers are watching this program, mm-hmm. also to learn about doing business in Poland. We often get the question at our chamber. There's so much going on in Poland. When we read the newspaper, so much negative mm-hmm. news about the Polish government, mm-hmm. and many entrepreneurs can have the choice for going to different countries, and not mm-hmm. not to Poland. What advice would you give? You live here, you experience what's happening here. What advice could you give to them?
Yeah, first of all, you have to believe in your own business, not depending on which politic is there, how long they will stay, because every country, we ask our colleagues in Holland, how is the Polish Dutch government, you always have also will have a good and a bad answer for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
The same as in Poland. So, mm-hmm. You need your own, running your own business, know where you're good in, and go steady.
Yeah.
That's the main thing I would say. And what I said before, you have to have something unique. Yeah. If it's yourself, it's the product, you need something what you can sell.
Well, of course, that's the market. Mm-hmm. But the question is about the politics. Is that bothering you?
No. To say it simple, no. Of course, sometimes it makes life for a certain period more difficult, but you have this, you have to solve this matter. So I don't see there on the long run any difference.
No.
One more question on this that you talked also about in the corridors, mm-hmm. When having coffee, about the difference in culture. What could you mm-hmm. I mean, you're half Polish now, I think. You've been here for a long time. Mm-hmm. What would you say on that?
It's correct. I would say in Poland, that's also what happened to me, more direct. Yeah, saying you have to do this. If I did the same in Holland, then sometimes could you not ask, could I do this? Yeah, and these are one of the things what are different. Yeah, they want direction process, they want to know it's black or white. Yeah, just not in between, because what to do? Yeah, and that's a little different where I believe I did not work in Holland that much, but that it's more in Holland some gray sometimes. Yeah, and here they want. No.
Jasne.
Let's get the record straight. Because I mentioned in the beginning, to how many companies are you exporting? And from how many companies are you importing?
It's correct. 17 importing, 70 exporting. Only what I'm saying to you, 11.
Okay.
Because for us, it's the most important markets are Central Eastern Europe. Okay. Means we supply to retailers our products from Estonia to Bulgaria to Ukraine. And this is the whole part we supply. And there are 11 countries. Hey, and the rest are once in the so many times it goes.
Okay,
both figures up to true.
Okay. And if I go to the shop and want to buy your product, I cannot buy a Euroshare, I think. But what are the brands that I...
Yes, it's correct. We did not focus on Euroshare, as the name is not for the consumer, not 100% correct. Goat Farm, a Dublin dairy. The Goat Farm is our goat and sheep cheese segment. We have Dublin here, this is our butter. We have Campio, this are the antipasti. This I should all remember all my brands by head now, but now you're so we have about 8 brands what we are focusing on. Yes.
Is this the best moment at this time for going to Poland with cheese, or is the time for cheese already over?
The time would never be over, but you need some new ideas. Investments. The thing is that Holland, of course, is a cheese country. Yeah. But to be honest, it's a cheese country, Gouda, with a taste, with a flavor, matured, not matured. So for export, it's quite narrow arrangement. That's why we have from Italy, we have from France, from Cyprus, from whole Europe. Otherwise, it's too narrow. Yeah. In Holland, you eat young belegen, and let's go on. Yeah. And it's here young, all with a taste.
Right.
What's your personal favorite?
Yeah, it's the old goat cheese, matured old goat cheese.
Okay.
That's the favorite.
Yeah. Okay, Mark, thank you very much for your time. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining us, and thank you everybody for watching the first edition of Business Matters Live. Before we finish this edition, I want to remind you of the upcoming events of the MBCC. On the 8th of March, we have the International Women's Day organized together with the IGCC. On 11th March, we have an online event, Meet Our Regional Board Member, Jasper Buter in Krakow. So you can hear more about doing business in Krakow and come in contact with our board member there. In the week of 15th of March, we publish our new bulletin, so that will come on your doorstep. On the 30th of March, we have an online members meeting that's open for everybody, so be very welcome to join that one. That's all for today. Don't forget to like us on Facebook and subscribe to us on YouTube. This will keep you updated on all our events. And also don't forget to tune in at our next Business Matters live on 25 March with more interesting guests. Thank you for watching and have a nice afternoon.
Thank you.